Well, good morning. Welcome to church. July 4th is just around the bend. We've made it through June. It's hard to believe, but here we are in July. Thank you for being faithful to the Lord's house this morning. I'm glad that you're here with us. I know some are out either camping, they're out at the lake, at the mountains, at the beach, or they're at home not feeling well, and we do want to welcome those at home that are watching, but thank you for being in God's house this morning. If you have your Bibles, we're going to look at Psalm 33, so go ahead and turn there with me if you would. If you don't have a Bible, you can look on the screen just behind me. Psalm 33, let's all stand together this morning. Psalm 33, this scripture denotes what the writer is saying about a nation who trusts in God and follows Him. And of course, this is our prayer for our nation, for America, and for our leaders. And as we come to the scripture today, and I know as we come to tomorrow's celebration, we need to pray for our mayor, the mayor in the town that we live in. We need to pray for our governor. We need to pray for our president. We need to pray for every elected leader, that God would give them wisdom and God would give them strength, and that America as a nation would live out what we're about to read, that we would call God our Lord. So I'll read verse 12, you'll read verse 18, and we'll finish all together on verse number 22. The psalmist writes, "Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord, and the people whom he hath chosen for his own inheritance. Behold, the eye of the Lord is upon them that fear him, upon them that hope in his mercy, to deliver their soul from death, and to keep them alive in famine. Our soul waiteth for the Lord, he is our help and our shield. For our heart shall rejoice in him, because we have trusted in his holy name." Altogether, verse 22. "Let thy mercy, O Lord, be upon us according as we have hope in thee." Dear Lord, this morning we thank you for the hope that we have in you. Lord, we are thankful that we have been saved. Those that know the Lord, God, we have a home in heaven. But Lord, we are also grateful that you saw fit to place us here in this great country. And Lord, we do pray this morning as we begin our service that you would have mercy and grace upon us, Lord, that you would help us to live lives of steadfastness and faithfulness, Lord, that no matter how many winds of change blow through this nation, politically, economically, Lord, culturally, that, Lord, you would cause us to stand strong and to be firm upon the truth. Lord, this morning we do pray for our mayor here, for the officials here in our city. Pray, Lord, for our governor, for his staff, for those that help to lead our state, those who are elected. Pray for our president and for his administration. Lord, that you would give each branch of the government, you give each elected official as well, give them wisdom. Lord, may they receive understanding. May they come to know you in full salvation. But Lord, may they want to follow you. And Lord, may they lead this town, this state, this nation, to worship you, to love you. And Lord, we know what we see. We're not naive. We know how things appear to be. But Lord, we rest in this. You sit on the throne, and you are in control. And Lord, we don't have to worry. We don't have to fret. We don't have to be anxious. Because Lord, you are God. This is your world. And we can rest in your strength and in your promises. So Lord, help us to call our great nation back to you. And we do that today, Lord, and we give this service into thy hands, and it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
God shed his grace on thee, and the God bless America, our wonderful home, sweet home. Lift it up and sing with us now.
God bless America, land that I love. Stand beside her and guide her through the night with the light from above. From the mountains to the prairies, to the oceans white with foam, God bless America, my home, sweet home. From the mountains to the prairies, to the oceans white with foam, God bless America, my home, sweet home.
Well, if you're visiting with us this morning, I know July 4th weekend is one where a lot of folks are, like we said, are at the lake, at the mountain, traveling on the road. Some are even at home sick this morning, and we pray for them. But if you're visiting, we have a visitor card either there in the pocket of the pew or at the Welcome Center. If you want to grab one of those and fill it out, if you'd like to get an email or a text just from us saying hello, we won't bother you. We just want to say hello and thank you for your visit. There is no evening service tonight. So please make note of that. But next Sunday night, we do have the Lord's Supper, and we'll be observing that in the evening service. There's a Mary Widow's Lunch on this Tuesday at 11 o'clock here at the church. So Mary Widows, please make note of that. There's no sign up for that. There is a calendar for July, and the red and the white paper made it too dark to see anything on the page, and the white one was just kind of ordinary, and we've done that before, so it's purple. So pick up a purple calendar for July at the back.
There is strength within the sorrow. There's a beauty in our tears. In our mourning, with a love that cast out fear. Lord, you are working while we're waiting. You're sanctifying us. When beyond our understanding, to trust. Oh, your plans are still to prosper. You have not forgotten us. You're with us in the fire and the flood. You're faithful forever, perfect in love. You are sovereign. Wisdom unimagined. Who could understand your ways? And you reign high above the heavens, reaching down in endless grace. You're the lifter of the lowly. You're compassionate and kind. You surround and you uphold me. And your promises are my delight. Oh, your plans are still to prosper. You have not forgotten us. You're with us in the fire and the flood. You're faithful forever, perfect in love. You are sovereign over us. Your plans are still to prosper. You have not forgotten us. You're with us in the fire and the flood. You're faithful forever, perfect in love, and you are sovereign over us. And even what the enemy means for evil, you turn it for our good. You turn it for our good and for your glory. And even in the valley, you've been faithful. You're working for our good. You're working for our good and for your glory. Even what the enemy means for evil, you turn it for our good. You turn it for our good and for your glory. And even in the valley you've been faithful. You're working for our good. You're working for our good and for your glory. Your plans are still to prosper. You have not forgotten us. You're with us in the fire and the flood. You're faithful forever, perfect in love, and you are sovereign over us.
Okay, 1 Corinthians chapter 4, and you can pull this one down. Thank you so much. Well, July 4th is almost here, and it's just amazing. I know it goes without saying, over the last couple of years, so many things have changed. And we went to the parade yesterday here in town. I remember 2 years ago, there was no parade. There was no fireworks. It was, you know, across the nation, things were a little bit different. And it's good that we can come at this time as we begin our service to remember and to remind ourselves that we need to pray, as the Bible says, for those in leadership, those in charge. Sometimes we wonder, those who are elected, those who are sent to Washington or Tallahassee or even locally, are they there? Do they know what they're doing? What is going on? Where are they? And other times we rejoice, other times we lament, but all the time we trust God because He's in charge and we can turn to Him. And we're reminded of that not only through each song we've sung, but through the passages we've read. And it's no different today in 1 Corinthians chapter 4. I love this passage, and we now literally are turning the page after being in the first three chapters of Corinthians for quite some time. And we're coming to a passage that really highlights the criterion or the what God says is a requirement for all of His servants, for those who would be a Christian, those who follow the Lord, those who know Christ. And that is summarized in one word that Paul gives here. It's found in verse number 2. It's being faithful. Faithfulness. And I think that's something we can all understand. It's something that we all know, we can define, we can put into a context, whether it's faithfulness in marriage, faithfulness to our job, faithfulness to our spouse, faithfulness to our country, faithfulness to our church, faithfulness, and we can name and go forth and go on. But faithfulness in the individual sense, as we're going to see today, I want you to personalize that and ask the Lord, am I faithful? Is this something in my life, in my right now, in my orb, in my sphere, am I faithful to you? Am I faithful in the things that I need to be faithful in? And only you can answer that. And God knows the answer to that question, and so do you. And I pray that as we look at these passages today, that God will speak to your heart. Well, last year in July, there was an article written by a man by the name of Ryan Holiday, and he wrote the article, and he started it this way, 18 Things I Stole from Some of History's Greatest Leaders. And I was like, okay, I was intrigued. And in reference to our study today, I was reading this article, and this is what he said. I want to give you a few quotes here. He says, people think that leadership is something that just happens. One is anointed, promoted, or born into leadership. And of course, that's not the case. And yet we're all leaders in one way or another, of our families, of a company, of a team, an audience, group of friends, even ourselves. Everyone, though, can benefit from learning some essential leadership lessons from some of history's greatest leaders. And so he listed 18 things that he said he took away from leaders. I'm not going to give you those 18. I do want to give you 5 that he said. And you see if you agree and go along with this. He says, first of all, things that you need from history's greatest leaders. Number one, a leader is a reader. Harry Truman famously said that not all readers are leaders, but all leaders are readers. They have to be. Number two, he says, a leader is not passionate. And I was kind of caught off guard with this one. He wrote, a young basketball player by the name Lew Alcindor Jr., later named Kareem, who won 3 national championships with John Wooden at UCLA, used one word to describe his coach and his coach's style, dispassionate, as in not passionate. John Wooden's style wasn't about being a cheerleader, giving speeches that were rah-rah, or screaming at his players from the sidelines. He saw those extra emotions as a burden. Instead, his philosophy was being in control, doing your job, and never being a slave to passion. Number three, a leader persists. Two words, a scholar said, should be committed to memory and obeyed. That is, persist and resist. Number four, he says, a leader stands up and stands out. And I like this particular analogy. There's a philosopher around the days of Nero named Agrippinus who once disregarded an invitation from Nero to attend a banquet. A fellow philosopher who did attend asked Agrippinus for an explanation, and he responded with this analogy. He said, people are like threads in a garment. Most people see it as their job to match all the other threads in color and in style. They want to blend in, so all the fabric will match. But I want to be the red, he said, that small and brilliant portion which causes the rest of the garment to appear beautiful. But be like the majority of the people? If I do that, how shall I any longer be red? He wanted to be red even if it meant being beheaded or exiled, and he was. It's interesting, a leader stands up and stands out. And he said, finally, a leader is always composed. On Wednesday, we spoke about Napoleon in a small fashion, and this is what he said. The first qualification of a general is having a cool head, being cool under difficult circumstances. And we see in his list, as I read through that, that there was one critical trait that was absent, one that was missing, and it's one that Paul mentions today. Maybe you're a reader, maybe you are passionate or dispassionate, maybe you are cool, calm, and collected. You've got all of these things. You stand up, you speak out, all of this. But the one trait that Paul mentions, and that is mentioned repeatedly throughout the Scripture, is one trait that so often is overlooked today. One that is so needed that if it is not present, it's like the pillars on the house. It begins to fold. It begins to fall. And that is faithfulness. And this is what Paul's going to write about. As I think of this verse, this is my dad's life verse, chapter 4, verse number 2. And when I think of faithfulness, I think of my dad. You know, my dad's still not back at church yet. As you know, he's been in ministry for a long time, and he's had several stints in the hospital since April, May, and June with his heart, with other things, a couple of strokes. And I think of my dad in this verse, and it's not pizzazz. It's not a flamboyance. It's not juggling flaming chainsaws and wowing the crowd, so to speak. None of which are qualifications for leadership. It's just what the old timers would say, a faithful plodder, someone that's just in the field, plowing the fields, and they're just going at their own pace, doing their thing, being faithful. When I think of that term, I think of my dad. Maybe you think of someone in your life, someone that always showed up, someone that was dependable, someone that was trustworthy, someone you could count on. The Bible says here, so we're going to look, that God is looking for people. In fact, it is a requirement for servants and stewards of God, those who would be His followers, that they be faithful. And boy, we need that today. The opposite of faithfulness, we look to the military world, they'd say it's someone that's gone AWOL, someone that's run. And do we see that in our ranks today among the church? Of course. There are many people who you can't find them. You don't know where they are. Spiritually speaking or physically speaking, sometimes they run, they're not there, and they're AWOL, but spiritually speaking, Paul says, it is so important that we are faithful. If I could give a title to this message, there would be so many, and I've written down so many. This is what I wrote, discerning fake news from false teachers versus good news from faithful teachers, or there is only one true judge, or how can we discern the ministry of the pastor or the teacher, or why should we be faithful? Or who is the judge and on what basis? This is what we're going to look at this morning. Let's look at 1 Corinthians chapter 4. We're going to read down to verse number 5. And note what Paul writes here. He says in verse number 1, let a man so account of us as of the ministers of Christ and stewards of the mysteries of God. Moreover, it is required in stewards that a man be found faithful. But with me, it's a very small thing that I should be judged of you or of man's judgment. Yea, I judge not mine own self. For I know nothing by myself, Yet am I not hereby justified, but he that judgeth me is the Lord. Therefore, judge nothing before the time until the Lord come, who both will bring to light the hidden things of darkness and will make manifest the counsels of the heart, and then shall every man have praise of God. It's so interesting that often we get ahead of ourselves in our judgment. And as we talked about in Sunday school, sometimes our perception of things is a little skewed. It's a little off. It's a little flawed. We are looking at something from a certain perspective. And I think of Patton. I think of the great generals. I think of MacArthur. You think of those and the different wars of our country. Or you think of Alexander the Great or Hannibal or Napoleon. You think of these great generals. And you look at aspects of leadership today. Those who can win championships. Those who have great skill in doing something. Oh, they're surely a leader. But the way we look at these things from our perspective, God looks at it a totally different way. And there might be people, as we're going to see this morning, according to the text, that don't appear to be anything great at all. They're nothing. And yet, in God's eyes, in His perspective, and it says it in this verse number 5, that if we judge before the time, we're going to be kind of fooled. When God judges on His day, as He says in chapter number 3, the gold, silver, precious stones, the wood, hay, stubble is going to be burned up. And the things that are burned up that we glamorized and looked at in this life might only be the things that are perishable, the things that will burn. And so Paul's mentioning to the church here, build your lives on things that will last, on things that will matter. It doesn't really matter how great a talent you have, how wonderful you look or you appear to be. It doesn't matter what's in the bank or what's hanging on the wall. It doesn't matter any of those things. Those are important things. But in God's eyes, it is about being faithful. It is about faithfulness in our own life. And it's the little thing that matters a great deal to God. And it's the little things that count. In fact, the little thing of faithfulness is really the big thing that brings it all down. If those little things aren't there, everything else falls apart. So am I faithful? Am I a faithful Christian? Am I a faithful believer? Am I a faithful person to the Lord Jesus Christ? And we have to ask ourselves that. Am I faithful to my spouse? Am I faithful to my family? Am I faithful in my job? Am I faithful in my commitments? And there are many folks who are very faithful to everything else other than the Lord. We have to ask ourselves that. And the verses say here, moreover, verse 2, it is required in stewards that a man be found faithful. So we see Paul, first of all, verses 1 and 2, he gives instruction. Number 2, and again, in the context here, as he's speaking about, he said that the church at Corinth, they were lifting up on pedestals men that were pastors, leaders. They were lifting up Apollos or Cephas, Peter or Paul. And they were saying, I'm of Paul, I'm of Apollos, I'm of Cephas. These are my guys. And they were lifting them up on pedestals and saying, these guys can do no wrong. Or, boy, that's not in my camp. And Paul is bringing them down and saying, we're nothing but servants. There's nothing special about us at all. So don't look at a pastor who has done great things for you to let that bolster your faith, or don't look at a pastor who has done horrible things to you to let it destroy your faith. And by the way, there's a lot of both going around. We have to look to the Lord, who is the foundation of the church, and each of us have to build on that foundation. So verses 1 and 2, he gives instruction on how the church should regard pastors and leaders and what's required. Verses 3 and 4, he gives an explanation on where he stands on being judged. He's not saying I'm above judgment, but he's saying, listen, you're judging men based on your flawed perspective. He says you need to look at it from God's perspective. And then number 3, verse 5, he makes an application. Now, we won't get to all those. We'll only get to verses 1 and 2. So what is the proper perspective, according to the text here, that we should have towards pastors and teachers and church leaders? Saw even this week another church leader has fallen, or it's come out, or it's been revealed that there's gross sin in his life, a public figure. And it's very sad. It's very disheartening. It's discouraging. It's upsetting when you see that and the people that they have hurt or the things that they have done. And I think in all of our lives, whether it be a pastor, a Sunday school teacher, a family member, someone that is a Christian, it hurts our heart. And then it kind of leaves a taste in your mouth when you're hurt or when you're ridden out on the rails or they say something or do something and then sin is discovered. Well, what Paul is going to say here is that none of us are without excuse, but those who lead the church are accountable to God. And God will hold them accountable. And their sin or their, we won't even say their faults, but their choices to do wrong or to do right, they do have bearing on those who hear it, but really we should follow the Lord despite what a leader says or does. And we need to make sure that what a leader says or does always lines up with the Word of God. And this is what Paul is saying. That's where faithfulness comes in. How are we to view this? I like how Pastor Alistair Begg heard this quote not long ago. He described this section. He says, therefore, as you look at leaders of the church, therefore those under their care are neither to we are neither to respond to them with hurtful denigration nor with harmful adulation, because either of those extremes will drastically diminish the effectiveness of the minister and at the same time dreadfully affect the local church itself. When you think about what happens to pastors and teachers in most local churches, it goes on a repeated basis, where at first they idolize you, and then once that is passed, they criticize you, and then they eventually ostracize you. So it's neither to be harmful adulation, which says that these teachers, preachers, can do nothing wrong. That's unhealthy. Nor is it to be hurtful denigration, where it says these pastors, teachers could never do anything right. So Paul is writing to the church about how they should view him and other leaders, and quite honestly, it's how we should view them today. Now, in the text here, it's very important because he gives two pictures to us. Here are the two pictures. Look at it. He says, verse number one, let a man or let the church, let people so account of us as of the ministers of Christ and stewards of the mysteries of God. So we're going to look at two points, and here they are. And then we're going to see the third point will be, what do these stewards or servants hold? What are they responsible for? So number one, he says, let a man so account of us as of the ministers of Christ. Number one, we're going to use this term servants, ministers. Now what is that? Now here he says, let a man look at us or consider us or account of us in this way. We are ministers. The word here means a under rower. Now, if you've watched Ben-Hur, that epic movie made, I think, in the late 40s, or maybe it was in the 50s. I think it was in the late 50s, 59. Charlton Heston was slave number 41. He was under the ship, remember? And he was chained as a galley slave to the bench, and they had the oars coming through and these Roman warships. So Paul is speaking to them, let a man so account of us, the pastor, teacher, that you put on the pedestal, church. He says, the ones that you've lifted up so greatly, we are nothing. We are called by God, but look at us as a galley slave. We are working for the captain of the ship. The Lord Jesus Christ is our master, and we do what he calls us to do. We are only servants. We are ministers. They were put in their position. In fact, it's a lowly position. It's not prestigious at all. The galley slave was chained to the bench, and they had to row. He was one who acted under direction. He asked no questions. He did what was appointed to do without hesitation, and he reported only to the one who was over him. And this is for the head of the church. Who is the head of the church? What does the Bible say? Christ is the head of the church. So there might be a pastor, could we say an under-shepherd? That would be a biblical term that we would use. But you don't answer to Jason Stevens. I'm not your boss. I'm not the one that you need to fear or cower or elevate or whatever. No. The head of the church is Jesus Christ. It's not a denominational body that is located in a state office somewhere, nor is it in a different country and it's one person who's speaking ex cathedra and this is how it is, nor is it some person that you'll never get to meet because they're too out of sight, out of touch for you little people. No, the Lord Jesus Christ is the head of the church, and Paul is writing to correct the Corinthians' view of favoritism and leadership in the church. They were lifting up men. Well, he's my favorite. This is the one that does it best. No, well, I was led to the Lord by Peter, and he walked with Jesus. Well, I was led to the Lord by Paul. And, you know, Paul also met Jesus, and he founded all these churches. So he really did it. And I was baptized by Jesus, so it really means something. Well, Jesus didn't baptize anybody, what we're told. And what we see here in Scripture is that the Corinthian church was puffing out their chest based on their position and who they were related to. This is my church. And it's not wrong to, please, it's not wrong to pray for your pastor to love the leaders of the church and to say, I'm thankful for you and I'm proud of you. I don't know if that's a way you put it, or I'm just thankful you're in my life. I tell you, I'm thankful for the pastors that were in my life growing up. All of those men are now with the Lord. And I think of those men in my life and the teaching I received and just being able to either go to lunch with them as a child and my dad would go and just being able to be around them. You almost felt like they were like Moses minus the beard coming down off the mountain when they get up there. And when you're a little kid, and my pastors were older. My final pastor, he passed away at 88 years old. And these men were just faithful servants of the Lord that love God, love people. They labored in it. There was nothing spectacular about them. They didn't jump up and run the aisles. They didn't step on the pews. They didn't slap people. They didn't take their jacket off and slay people. They didn't do any of that stuff. And I mean, there's a lot of that stuff going around. And I guess maybe some people do need to be slayed. And if you know someone, line them up and I'll slap them with my jacket. But to be faithful just means to be consistent, to be trustworthy, to be dependable, not just to people, but most importantly, to the Lord. And there are things that verse 5 says that we judge on, but one day when we stand before God, He's going to peel back all the layers and say, here's why you did it. Not just what you did, but here's why you did it. And it makes us really look at our own lives. Why are we doing the things that we are doing? Who are we doing them for? What's the purpose behind them? Because one day we will all stand before the Lord, Paul says. We are all galley slaves. I kept writing in my notes this past week, and every time I came to certain terms, it would say, you can't use that term, or it would try to correct this term and this biblical language. But that's what we are. We are ministers. We are slaves. We are under the direction of Jesus Christ. He is our captain. So not only did he say we are servants, but number two, look at verse number one. Let a man so account of us as of the ministers or servants or slaves of Christ and stewards of the mysteries or the secret things of God. What is a steward? So, first of all, servant, galley slave. You say, I don't like that. Well, Paul constantly talked about that. I'm a slave of Jesus Christ. I'm a bondservant of Jesus Christ. I belong to Jesus. And that just simply means that it brings comfort in knowing I belong to someone. And I have an identity that is not found in this world. The world tries to identify everyone, and they want you to identify yourself in certain ways. But we can identify with Christ. I belong to Him. He wants me. I want the Lord. But more than my desire to want the Lord, He wants me. He wanted me. He saved me. And it's the same with you. God sent His Son into the world, not to condemn the world, but that the world through Him might be saved. There's condemnation already, but He sent Jesus. Jesus came to seek and to save. And often at church, sometimes maybe I feel like it's coming across too hard. Oh man, I hope but it has to be what the Bible says. And truly it is that sin is condemning and there are sinners and we are born wrong, but Christ came to save. He came to seek them out and to save them. And when we are saved, we are placed into and adopted into the family of God. We get to work for the Lord. We serve Him. And it's not that we don't care what other people think, but ultimately I'm going to stand before the Lord Jesus Christ, not a group of Baptists, not a group of Mormons, not a group of JWs, not a group of Catholics, whoever. I'm going to stand before the Lord, and so are you. We all will stand individually before the Lord. And Paul writes here, in that day all things will be revealed, manifest, he says. Are we ready for that? We are servants of the Lord. And he's saying this specifically to pastors, but generally speaking, it's to every single believer. Number two, we are stewards. What is a steward? Well, a steward in this time in the ancient world was also a slave and owned nothing, but he managed the master's house. He was a manager. Now, just by a simple poll, not scientific, how many of you have ever been or you currently are a manager of something? I'm not going to ask you what it is or why, okay? Well, if you're a mom or dad, you're a manager of whatever, okay? You clean up your room, clean up your plates, or take out the trash. But managers, maybe you don't own the fast food restaurant, but you're the manager of it. You are a parent, so you kind of do own it. So if you don't break it, if you didn't buy it, whatever it is. But as a parent, you're a manager. We all understand the concept. A steward is a manager who is taking care of something that was given to him into his trust. He doesn't own it, but he is responsible for it. I like this commentary. Adam Clark said this: the steward was the master's manager in regulating the concerns of the family. He went out and provided food. He saw to it that it was served at the proper time and in proper quantities. He received all the cash, expended all that was necessary for the support of the family. He kept exact amounts for which he was obliged at certain times to lay before the master and be scrutinized. So if you think about someone who's a manager, you'll know immediately that that person is not the one who has the ultimate responsibility. Maybe, I know the popular term today, and I apologize if your name is this, I'm not deriding your name, but the popular term today is Karen. You know, and maybe you've heard someone say, can I speak to the manager, please? And you're just like, I just work here. You know, did you want fries with that? I mean, what's wrong? Can I speak to the manager? And the manager, they're trying to go to someone above someone that works for the manager to say, I need to speak to someone in charge. But even there's someone above the manager. Paul saying, the pastor, teacher, leader of the church is a galley slave who looks to the captain on the bridge and says, Lord, from your word, not mine, but Lord, from your word, what do you want me to say? What do you want me to do? Does he always get it right? No way. Does he get it wrong sometimes? Yes way. Does he get it right some of the time and wrong some of the time? Of course. Anytime we deviate from God's word and we do it our way, we get it wrong. But he says, I'm a servant, I'm a slave, but I'm also entrusted with something from God. So he says, I am a manager of what God has given me. So what are they stewards of? Note the verse here. He says they are stewards of, verse number one, see it, of the mysteries of God. Whoa, that sounds very ominous. What is the mystery of God or the mysteries of God? Well, what we can know, what we can see, is it's not some thing out there that's nebulous, that's floating around that we can't understand, because the Bible says that it's been revealed in the person of Jesus Christ. That which was promised has come. Nothing has to be fulfilled for our salvation. Nothing that you have to do except believe it and receive it and know that Christ is the Savior and the Messiah. He's been entrusted with the gospel of Jesus Christ, and he must share that. So they managed in the sense of preserving and protecting, and they dispensed the truth in the sense of distributing the truth of God. So they have been entrusted. That's why it's so important what we say and what we share at this church and behind the pulpit. Let me say this, and I wrote this down to make sure I got this right. Like many pastors, I've also been frequently asked to say things behind the pulpit or to say certain things, maybe a political agenda or direct some social activity or find better ways to entertain people or to be more pragmatic in order to draw people in. And the list goes on. There's all kinds of things. Hey, let's, and maybe they're coming from a place of, even a lot of pastors get it, of just wanting to help. But sometimes it's even with the agenda of, if you would do this or if this church would do that, then we could be more of. And ultimately, Paul is reminding them of his responsibility to the captain, to the one who placed him in the position, the one who placed him as an under-rower. So it's not what we concoct, a pastor, leader, a teacher, or what they think. It's what does the Bible say? In fact, we as pastors or leaders or teachers have been entrusted with the things of God. And it's something that Paul is saying here. We are here to share God's word, not our own opinions. Our mantra must be, what does the Bible say, not what do we think about it? And there are a lot of things that we like to share and sometimes talk about, and many pastors do. And sometimes the things that we share or do might be good ideas, but if we deviate off of Scripture, off of what God has said, that's where we get into the weeds, which is where when I used to play a little bit of golf, where I spent a lot of times in the woods and in the weeds and in the water, which you can't really recover from. You ever heard preaching that's in the weeds, in the water, in the woods? Well, that's fluff. And I'm saying that as someone who's shot a lot of fluff before and will shoot fluff again. But ultimately, our adherence is not what do I think, what do you think I should think, what do I think you should think, what do they think in Hollyweird or in Washington, what do they think, what does the world say, but what does God say? What does God's word say? What does the Bible say? So a good steward only cared about this. Did I tell you the truth? Did I tell you the truth? We see that in Scripture. Do we become an enemy to someone because we tell them the truth? Sometimes. The truth hurts. The truth is not often easy. A spoonful of sugar, right? Makes the medicine go down, as the old song says. But the truth is something that can save the soul of the one that's nearest hell. The truth can turn people around. Therefore, it's important when we put these pieces together in this instruction that he provides, it becomes obvious that a congregation is correct in viewing its pastors and leaders as servants and as stewards, or as slaves and as managers. But it's incorrect for a congregation to view itself as the master. Who is the master of us all? That's the Lord Jesus Christ. It's the one who is in charge. That distinction is often missed. So Paul is saying we don't originate truth. The truth comes from God. We are here to dispense it, to give it, and to not just, can we say this, not just to give it. You need to do this. You need to do this. You need to do this and not live by it. And this is what Paul's talking about. It's required, verse 2, in stewards, servants, those who are giving this out, you do this. Do as I say, but not as I do. I watched a clip of a pastor the other day. I'll say the name because he's out there. And I didn't watch the entire clip, but he said he apologized for tithing. And Creflo Dollar. I would like to have a name like that, my last name, Pastor Dollar. That would be really cool. Or Pastor whatever it is. You think of whatever name it might be. Pastor Strong. Pastor Awesome or something. See, this is the weeds. This is the woods. This is the water. But he... In this short clip, he apologized. A man who has multiple Cessnas, Bugattis, homes, million-dollar home, all these things, and apologize is maybe a loose way. He didn't really apologize. I know in the economy we're in, a lot of people are doing different things to get by, but here's a pastor who's lived high on the hog for decades and is now coming out and making concessions about some things that he has said and wanted that he'll do and not do without. The servant of God is not someone that is lifted up on a pedestal nor climbs on it himself. That's wrong. Anyone that stands behind this pulpit or any pulpit, according to God's word, they are to be a servant, a minister, a steward. They are chained to Christ. Lord, what would you have me to do? Lord, what does the Bible say? Not how do I feel about it. Not they're going to hate me, and they might. They don't like this, but the truth that is presented must be a truth that is also practiced. And that's what is often missing here. We need the truth to be practiced, not just preached. It is important to preach it, because we're commanded to do that. But we're also commanded to practice the truth we preach. And that not only goes for a pastor to congregation, that goes to parents to kids. If we're telling our kids not to do something and then we're turning around doing it, then what is that called? For a pastor to tell you and not do it for a parent to tell? That's hypocrites. We've got to do it God's way. That's why that term faithful, consistent, trustworthy, dependable, someone that will do what the captain says, someone that is managing the owner's resources well. And I'll say this, it tells us a lot about the responsibility of a man who stands behind the pulpit and teaches the Word of God. He's responsible to God, not to those that hear. Now, here's the caveat. It's been abused by many church leaders before where they say, do as I say, not as I do, but it's so important. The sinfulness of others, whether they be church leaders, your parents, teachers, will not excuse my own sin. It doesn't change what God says. We've talked about this before. Many of us, many of you, no doubt, even those listening at home, have been hurt by someone behind one of these in a place like this, from someone on a pedestal or someone not on a pedestal. Just someone has gotten into the woods, into the weeds, and into the water. They haven't, their lives haven't lined up with the truth. They chose to do wrong and to hurt someone. And that is sin. That is wrong. And it deserves to be called out, and it should be, and it will be at this church. But their sin and what they did will not excuse my own sin of how I respond and what I do about it. Well, you don't know what they did to me. Do you see what they did to the Lord? And I have to remind myself of that, because my daddy and his dad before him worked in church. And one reason why, like so many of you who maybe have family ministry, as a kid, I didn't want to go to work in church. I did want to go to church. I didn't want to work in church as I got older, because I saw what some things happened in church, and it was like from Christians. But someone else's sin won't excuse my own, my lack of complacency or bitterness toward them or unforgiveness or whatever it might be. Paul is saying to the Corinthians, don't put us up on pedestals. He kept climbing off of it. He says, that's not us. We work for the Lord. We are slaves. We are stewards. Two passages. Turn, if you would, to 1 Peter chapter 4, if you would. 1 Peter chapter 4. We're right at the time to close. 1 Peter chapter 4. And this is what he says. Lest we think this is just for pastors, and you see this throughout Scripture, that they are stewards. 1 Peter, Peter's writing to the church here, and he says that every Christian is a steward, a manager. So before we read this, I want you to ask yourself, what has God given you? Well, I don't have anything. What has God given you? Maybe He's given you a family. He's given you your health. Maybe He's given you a little bit of resources, a home. He's given you life and breath. He's given you some things that are tangible and some intangible things. What, ask yourself, what am I doing with the resources God has given me? What am I doing with those resources? You ever heard the saying, that money's burning a hole in their pocket? You know what I'm talking about, where they got a hole in their pocket. You know, maybe it's a kid or it's an adult or someone, they get a dollar, they're going to spend it immediately. You know, Jesus gave parables about that. When He left as the owner and He gave it to the servants, the stewards, He says, here's this, here's this, here's this. Make sure you take care of it. And they went out and did it, and one dude dug a hole and buried it, the resource that the owner had given to him. What does God want you to do with what God has given you? So often we buy into the mentality that is prevalent in American society is, I have lifted myself up by my own bootstraps. And I like those stories. I think of the cowboys and the guys who fashioned and built America, and those that are just hardy men and women, and they pull themselves up by their own bootstraps. But we know, I mean, it's in the movies. People are tough, but they don't get there by themselves. But ultimately, for the Christian, we've been given everything. We've been blessed. That's the word we use. I'm blessed. We've been blessed by God. What am I doing with what God has given me? And this is not the part where, come on up, Pastor Chris, and we're going to play the music, and let's pass the plate. We're going to pass the plate until we reach the thermometer. And the thermometer is whatever X amount that we want on it. And sometimes we go to God's house, or we're in church, or we see those kind of things as fundraising mechanisms, or They're just trying to hold me over a barrel so I can feel guilty if I don't go serve in nursery or if I don't do this or that. What Paul says here, the one requirement is found in chapter 4, verse 2, faithfulness. You don't have to be a fantastic teacher, juggle flaming chainsaws, which would be kind of cool on a Wednesday night. The kids would love that, as long as no one loses a hand or a head or a leg or something. I don't know. If you could do it, but faithfulness is the key. And it takes no special talent to be faithful. It takes nothing special, just being faithful. Showing up, as my dad used to say, when the doors are open. Or in your marriage. Do you sometimes feel married? No. Do you sometimes feel like a parent? No. Maybe we should ask our kids that. Sometimes you just feel miserable. You're sick or you're beat down and you're tired after a long day at work and you come in and you just, and you don't feel very even sometimes saved. But thank God, we don't live by our feelings. If I was saved by my feelings, I would have been unsaved by 4 o'clock that day. Hello? We are not saved by our feelings. We're saved by our faith in what Christ has done. Not in what I have done, because I will forget what I've done at some point. What Christ has done for me. So Paul says, we are servants, we are stewards. Here's the verse, 1 Peter 4, verse 10 and 11. As every man or every person hath received the gift, even so minister the same one to another, as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. He says, every man, every person, if you're a Christian, if you're a believer, you've received that from the Lord. You are saved. The Holy Spirit's taken up a residence in you. You are His. You belong to Him. Get busy. What are you doing? We all have a job to do. Then finally, this is my third point, and it's the shortest one. So what's the standard for evaluating back to 1 Corinthians? And you probably know the verse already. We've quoted it many times. Verse number 2. What's the standard for evaluating? For evaluating ministry, first of all, amongst those who've been given to the church as servants and stewards. How should we judge them if there is a judgment that is given? It's not based on chainsaws. Or, as we're going to see in a minute, other worldly standards. The great requirement, verse 2, moreover, it is required. Can you say it with me? 1, 2, 3, required. Wow, weak. 1, 2, 3, required. So required, that means it's necessary. It's supposed to be present in the life of those that was just listed. And we know it's not just for those who are pastors or teachers, but for every Christian. So for Christians, the great requirement is that a man be found faithful. It's not ingenuity, flamboyance, novelty, eloquence, or personality. And boy, we could do with a lot of those up here, couldn't we? I could, you know, come on. I remember I preached a message when I was a youth pastor years and years and years ago, before 2000, and I was preaching from Isaiah 53, and my wife, who's, I think she's in the nursery, she'll remember this, but I was preaching on Isaiah 53, and so I was wearing my suit and my tie and all this, and had it buttoned up. I think I even had a vest on back in those days. A vest was still kind of in vogue, not so much now. And when I got to the part, I took off my jacket, and my shirt was like all ripped up, and it had like red spots. And it's like I was trying to symbolize like blood and the whipping that Jesus took. You know, I tried to, the woods and the weeds and the water, the fluff. And I don't know if it had anything, but I had to wear that the entire morning through Sunday school with no one noticing and making sure. And then finally the payoff, I got to take my jacket off. The pizzazz, the flamboyance, the ingenuity, the novelty. And boy, if I can really take something and I could be pragmatic about it, and maybe the pastor next week should, from the sound booth to the baptistry, if I can get on a zip line from there to there and get in the baptistry, and I can have 2 children that are getting baptized, and I will zip line to the baptistry, and I will dunk them in Jesus' name, that would make the news, let me tell you. Especially if I got it wrong, and we fell like on the first pews, but or missed the baptistry. There's so many things that are being done today in the name of Jesus that, or that Jesus gets blamed for, that are not found in Scripture. The wood, the weeds, and the water. And we're off in a different direction. So this word faithful means trustworthy, credible, believe. It's used when something was under review, when the books were submitted for scrutiny. The master would look at the books and say, okay, everything's in order. You've done everything right. You know, one day the Bible says the books will be open and God will look at the books of our life. This morning in Sunday school, we talked about some pineapple juice that was in my fridge that had gone bad, and I looked at it and I said, so what's in the refrigerator of your life? You know, you open this thing up, oh my goodness, you got to deal with it. Well, God is going to look at all of our lives one day and say, to our face, into His face, what'd you do with what I gave you? Why'd you dig a hole and bury it? Why'd you just shove things aside? Why didn't you live up to what I called you to do? And I can't adequately do this word justice, but how do we often standardize or evaluate effectiveness in church? I'm going to give you three B's, and then we're going to get to the conclusion. And I'm going to apologize for the third B, but this is church lingo. How do we standardize or judge effectiveness in today's church world? Buildings, budgets, and butts. That's what they say. You say, well, what does that mean? Well, buildings, budgets, and butts. How many people are there? How many buildings do you have? And how large is your budget? Now, again, I'm not preaching this message. If you're new here, I'm not preaching this message because there's a problem. We have been going through 1 Corinthians for the last, year. And this is the next, we just turned the page 2 weeks ago from Noah now to here. And that is so true. You know what? Next month we pay off this building. Praise the Lord. Pastor Ken and Miss Helen are coming back. I am so thankful. We are going, I don't know how you party when you pay off something, but we're going to party. It's going to be great. We're going to celebrate because God's people have been faithful to give through the year so that this building, which is now 16 years old, has been, as we got one more payment. Praise the Lord. Two more payments. Well, this month and next month. We're almost there. We're done. And that's due to the faithfulness of God who has enabled those people who are here to be faithful to their church. And the church leaders have been faithful to dispense what has been given to them. And next month we're going to invite the guy who God used to build it. And I'm so thankful for that. And it's been faithful, but it's not how many buildings we have, how wonderful our budget is, or how many butts are in the pew. And I'll tell you, a lot of times that's where the line of thinking is. It's not on the gifting of the pastor or his personality or other flaw factors. For stewards, the most important thing was faithfulness. So when you're greeting people in the morning, if you're standing out there shaking hands or holding the door, it's about faithfulness. If you're a Sunday school teacher or you work in children's church, it's about being faithful. If you're bouncing a baby, which I don't know what that is, totally on your knee in the nursery, and they're doing that this morning, it's about being faithful. If you serve in the sound booth, it's about being faithful. If you sing in the choir, it's about being faithful. If you pass the plate, if you send a text, you write a card, you make a visit, it's about being faithful. Faithfulness undergirds every area of church life, and a lack of it will erode everything about the church. There'll be four people here present. Well, you know, I've just got other things, whatever. And it's not just physical faithfulness, but we show that we're trustworthy, dependable, and reliable in our own lives by showing up. And that's half the battle, just being faithful. Turn to Psalm 696. Pastor Chris, would you come? I've gone just a tad bit longer this morning. Psalm 696. I love this song. And I want us to end with this morning before we take our offering. So in asking the Lord how we could conclude this idea of faithfulness, you know, Thomas Chisholm wrote a great song. Thank you, ushers. They're getting ready. Thomas Chisholm wrote a great song, Great Is Thy Faithfulness, which that's good. It's talking about the Lord's faithfulness. But I was like, Lord, is there something else that we can share, something else? Well, Psalm 696 in your books, it's a hymn that a lot of people don't really know. We don't sing very often. But this song was written in 1903. The words just were going through my mind as I was writing the end of the message earlier in the week. And I'm like, I need to go look at this. The story behind the song is what I find most fascinating. So I know in your hymn book, it just gives, I think, a G dot Y, maybe. I don't even know if it gives his full name, but it's G dot Young. His name is George Young. He was born in 1855. He was an obscure preacher and a carpenter. He served in a small rural area. His income at the church and being a carpenter was so meager that he barely survived. In fact, he struggled to support his family. And after many years of sacrifice and effort, George built a house, with his own hands, and they moved into it. But while he and his family were away preaching in another area, there were some young men. It said young men or young people. They were people that didn't appreciate the message that he preached. They set fire to the house that they had built and burned it to the ground. Instead of quitting, complaining, or blaming God, he never lost his faith, and out of this tragedy of losing everything that they owned, he wrote this hymn, which is based, and I know in our hymn book it says one particular verse, but it's actually based on Job 35, verse 10, from his own words, which says, "He gives me songs in the night." The hymn describes various circumstances and experiences we all face in life with a reminder that the Lord is faithful to lead us through them all. The opening verse paints a picture like the 23rd Psalm, but the writer understood that not all of life is like that. You know, Christians are not Pollyanna-esque, or we're not naive. Note verse 1, "In shady green pastures, so rich and so sweet, God leads His dear children along. Where the waters cool flow, bathes the weary one's feet, God leads His dear children along." The verse, or the refrain, gives a more sobering view. Some through the waters, some through the flood, some through the fire, but all through the blood. I love that line. Some through great sorrow, but God gives a song. That's Job 35:10. In the night season and all the day long. Some through great sorrow is a reference to Young's own experience. He learned through painful loss that God gives songs in the night. This is not the message today, but it's easy to be like Elijah when it's dark. You know, Elijah ran away, and he said, "It's enough. I don't want to do this anymore. It's hard. I don't like it. I'm alone. Nobody's with me. I'm exhausted. I don't like this." And he says, "God, just take me to heaven. I'm done." And even when Elijah was at his lowest point, God was still with him and encouraged him. And maybe you feel like that for whatever reason, with your parents, with your kids, with your spouse, with your job, with this economy, with whatever is going on. Some through great sorrow, but God gives a song. Christians know that this is not the end. And maybe you have had a long night this last year. It's been difficult the last week or the last few days. But God continues to lead His dear children along in good times and bad. Perhaps some think that God, if He is our guide, our lives should never be touched or hurt. But that's not the case. Jesus warned, "If they persecuted me or if they hated me, they will hate you." More often now, rather than delivering us from hard times, the Lord helps us in them and carries us through them. George Young died in 1935. Last part. I know this is a lengthy conclusion. 1942, Haldor Lillenis, who wrote a lot of songs, "The Wonderful Grace of Jesus" is one. He wanted to find George Young's widow. Again, George was very poor. They didn't have a lot. Lost their home. He died 7 years earlier. He sought to find his widow. He found an address in a small town, and he drove there. Stopping at a gas station, he asked for directions. When the attendant saw the address, he said, "Sir, that's the county poorhouse 3 miles up the road." And when I say poorhouse, I mean poorhouse. Not knowing what to expect, Mr. Haldor made his way there. He found Mrs. Young, a tiny, elderly woman in surroundings that were far from pleasant. However, his words, quote, "She radiated the joy of the Lord and spoke of how God guided her and her husband over many years. Then she exclaimed, quote, 'Dr. Lillenis, God led me here. I'm so glad He did. For you know, about every month, someone comes into this place to spend the rest of their days. So many of them don't know my Jesus. I'm having the time of my life introducing them to Him. Dr. Lillenis, isn't it wonderful how God leads? I'm thankful that God brought me to this place to minister to so many in need.'" Here's a widow in those days that, I've seen the pictures of the place and of the time. No matter where you and I, no matter where we are, what we're going through, or what we're facing, God has given us a resource, something that we are to do. Even if I can't rub two nickels together, I got a song in my heart, song in the night. God can use me to be a blessing to others. Be faithful, not just from the pastor here, the congregation, all of us, parents, husbands, wives, grandparents, church members, whatever. Let's be faithful. Let's pray this morning.